This tutorial will show you how to use the Dodge and Burn panel in Raya Pro 3. Here we can use various dodge and burn techniques to give our images lots of life. And the three top buttons are probably the most useful ones in this panel. They allow us to target specifically the highlights, midtones, and shadows in a non-destructive way. For example, if I want to just target the midtones, I don't want to target the highlights or the shadows, I can press the midtones button. Then I come up with this dialog, and this allows us to shape our mask any way we want. So I'm going to bring along the shadows here, and we're really just targeting the midtones. We don't want to affect the highlights or the shadows. When we're happy with that, we can press OK. And this is our midtones layer. Now we can press the brush. We can make a large brush, which will set the default size of our brush to 2000. We can make our brush smaller by pressing this minus button or the plus button, and that'll make it smaller or larger by 250 pixels. If you're using Photoshop CS6, the first time you press this button when you open Photoshop, it might take a second to load, but every other time you press it after that, it will load quickly. CC users, it will load quickly for you automatically. And now we can choose our color. So let's say we want to dodge the highlights. I can press this white button here, and it makes our foreground white. Now, with the layer selected and not the mask, we can simply paint on the midtones, and you see we're brightening them up. Now we can change this effect by going to this button here called Overlay. Right now this layer is set to soft light. We can change that to Overlay to create a stronger effect, or Vivid Light to create a really strong effect, which doesn't look very good in this image. So I'm going to go for Overlay, and I'm going to bring the opacity of this layer down because it's a little bit strong. So there's the before and after, and a little bit more again. And so now I can brighten up the midtones completely non-destructively, as opposed to the destructive method that we often use with the default functions in Photoshop. So there you go, there's your before and after. Now if you want to burn any areas, so if you want to make them darker, we can select black as the foreground, and we can paint in some of these areas like this. And you see we're burning those areas. Now why don't we see if we can make some nice changes to the shadows. Now when this comes up, you'll see we have a lot of the image selected, and that's because this is quite a dark photo. So to target the darkest part of the image, we really have to bring that black point slider all the way along. And that should just about do it, and press OK. Now watch what happens if I choose a white foreground, and I paint, let's say, in the darkest part of the image, so here. You see we're brightening it up. We're dodging it beautifully. And if we paint over the highlights, nothing's happening. That's because we haven't got the highlights selected in our shadows layer. And if we want to burn the shadows, we can choose a black foreground and just paint in some of those areas. Now, if it's a little bit strong, we can undo that. We can reduce the opacity of our brush, let's say to 30%, and just gently paint in some of these shadows. So there's the before and after. So you can see we're beautifully dodging and burning these areas without affecting the colors as well, because often when you dodge and burn, you'll see increases in saturation. We can also affect the highlights if we want, but that's exactly the same process as the shadows and midtones. But before we move on to different functions, let me show you a different way to dodge and burn, but this time with color. If I go to a different example here, so we have these trees in the foreground and I want to add a little bit of warmth to them. So what I can do is, because they're in the shadows, I can press shadows and bring this slider along and just try to isolate the trees. So there you go, we're isolating the trees, making them nice and white without affecting the mountains too much in the background. So when we're done, we press OK, and we've already got our brush selected. So we can choose one of these different tones, whichever suits us. So let's say I can choose this one here. And then with an opacity of 100%, I can paint in these trees, and obviously that looks crazy. So I can then bring down the opacity of that layer significantly. So there's the before and after. See, we're adding just a little bit of warmth. Now, if that doesn't work particularly well, we can change the color of our foreground and try a different color. Just again, paint in those trees, bring up the opacity, and there's the before and after. You see, we've added some beautiful warmth to those trees now. And this one looked a lot more natural than the previous color. So we can paint in this tree as well. So just to make that a little bit more obvious, I'll bring up the opacity again. There you go. There's the before and after. Now, if you want to paint it a different color, let's say a light green, we can press this eye tool and that will create an eyedropper. And let's say we had a light green color in our image, we could simply click on it and that would now be our foreground color. Now, by the way, if you're doing that and you're using the eyedropper, we have to change this to where it says sample to all layers. And then when we sample anywhere, you'll see we're changing the foreground color. Now, if you don't have a light green color or the color that you want to dodge or burn, we can simply press this foreground button and we can choose the color manually. So let's say I'm gonna scroll down a bit and go for a greeny kind of yellow and then press okay. Now again, I can press my brush and just start painting in that color. And again, down here too. It doesn't look very good, but it's just a quick example. And I bring down the opacity and there's a before and after. And that looks a lot more natural. So we've now got some lovely colors in our trees in the foreground. So you can see we can dodge and burn pretty much anything. We can dodge and burn sunsets, sunrises, shadows, midtones, and we can add beautiful color, any color we want to any of those areas. But what about the other functions? Let's go back to our Antelope Canyon image. And here we have something called merge. And this is used typically when we want to do traditional dodging and burning. So if you want to use this, you can't just press merge when there is an invisible layer selected. Instead, we have to delete those layers. And obviously we can't press merge either when we just have one layer. It's much better just to press Command and J or Control and J to duplicate that layer. But let's say you have a few different layers like this. Oops, I'll remove the black and white one. And then you want to create a merge layer. You just press merge. Now you have a layer which has all of your previous layers merged together to make one complete layer. And if we want to dodge and burn, we can press dodge. And that will bring up the dodge tool to the left there. Or if you want to burn, you can press the burn button and that will bring up the burn tool. And there's the sponge tool. Now this is a destructive way of dodging and burning, but it's there just in case you prefer to dodge and burn that way. Another way to dodge and burn is through a 50% gray layer. If we click on that, we can do exactly what we did previously. So we can choose a brush, choose a white foreground, and we can burn or dodge any area we want and change the blend mode to change the strength. The problem with this dodge and burn layer is that it doesn't affect specific tones. It affects every single tone in the image. So it's much better to use the highlights, midtones, and shadows options. And finally, there's a curves dodge and burn option where we create a curves layer, choose a white brush, and we can paint in that dodge and burn layer. And you see we're giving our image more contrast. So we darken our shadows and brighten the highlights and midtones. And if we don't want to affect the colors in the image, we can open this drop-down box and go to luminosity. And that will change the contrast without affecting the colors. Now to move on to the next section, here we have detail shadow, detail lights, and glow free. So I'm going to delete these layers, and detail shadows will allow us to add details to our shadows. So if I click on that, I can bring up this slider. The larger the radius, the more local contrast we create, and then I can press OK. And then of course I can create the mask I want. So I can just bring this all the way along. So we're just affecting the darker shadows and press OK. And there's the before and after. Just in case you can't see it, I'm going to zoom into this area here, and there's the before and after. So we're making some soft local contrast. If you want to strengthen this effect, you can change this layer to vivid light. And there's the before and after. And so that's what it looks like on the rest of the image. And of course, if it's too strong, you can always bring down the opacity of that layer. And now if we want to add detail to our highlights or midtones, we can press detail lights and we can create some strong local contrast, press OK, and again we're going to be asked to shape our mask. So I can bring this along as much as I want, bring the shadows one along, so we're really just targeting the midtones and the highlights here, and then press OK. So there's the before and after, and obviously that's really strong, so we can bring down the opacity of this layer significantly. And let me zoom into this area here. So we have these beautiful textures in the canyon, and that's before and that's after. So we're emphasizing those textures. And again, if I change that to vivid light, we're making even more contrast in those areas. Now for glow free, this is just a simple layer where we can paint in any extra light areas that we want to, just manually painting in freely wherever we want. You see, we're creating a soft, light glow in the scene. Next, we have zone contrast. If I click on that, it might take a few seconds to run the full function because it's creating a lot of curve layers. And now we have a folder called contrast zones. We have 6 curves here, and this one targets general highlights. So I'm going to show you the general highlights. This one targets the specific highlights. This one targets the general shadows. This one, the specific shadows, and this one, general midtones, and this is a stronger midtones. So, what does that mean in practice? Well, if we choose highlights 1, and we can increase the contrast, you see we're brightening up the highlights and the upper midtones. However, if I choose highlights 2, that's affecting just the upper highlights, so just the rays in the canyon. If we choose the shadows, I can brighten up the shadows or I can darken the shadows, but it's also darkening the midtones too. But if I go for a more specific shadows mask, that's targeting the shadows, but if I bring it down, you see we're still protecting the upper midtones. And now if we go for the general midtones, we can brighten up the midtones without affecting the highlights or the shadows, and this should give us an even stronger effect. So zone contrast allows us to change contrast according to that specific tonal range in our image. And once we create these, anytime during our workflow, we can return to them and make small changes to affect the image. Now, if you want a quick contrast adjustment, S-curve will do exactly that. It's a really strong contrast adjustment, but we can bring down that opacity all the way. And there you go. Now I'm going to take us back to this landscape image. And why don't we press S-curve just to give it a bit of contrast? I'm going to bring down the opacity a bit. Now we have something here called dark sky. And essentially, this is going to darken all of the highlights in our image. So if we have any highlights, it doesn't have to be a sky, it could be street lamps or anything. It will essentially darken and often add more color to that area. So if I press dark sky, you'll see it's darkened mainly the sky and some of the fog in the foreground. We can always press adjust to actually make that a more targeted mask. So that's pressing adjust in the Raya Pro Hub. I'm going to delete that layer. Here we can brighten up our highlights. So those are our brighter highlights. Here we can protect our shadows. So we're essentially bringing the brightness up in our shadows just in case they're starting to get clipped, a little bit underexposed. We can lighten the shadows, which will brighten them even more. You'll see it has a much more general effect. And I'm going to delete that. Or we can use something called fake HDR. And this will bring back some of those brighter areas and brighten up some of those shadowy areas. See, we have a flatter scene now, which will stop us from having any under or overexposed areas. Now, in case you don't know the Orton effect, that essentially allows us to create a nice, beautiful, dreamy effect in our image. So if I press the Orton effect here, and I can change the radius as much as I want, but I'm going to leave it at 47. And I have a levels dialog, which I can bring up or down, depending on the image I'm working with. And then I can bring down the opacity, of course, let's say to 12% or 10% there. And so now we have a nice, dreamy mood. I'm going to make that a bit larger for you, just so you can see it. It's much softer. And where this really excels here is in the fog, the mist in the foreground. So you can always create a mask on that layer, press Command and I or Control and I and invert that mask. And then you can just paint in the fog in that area. So it's a nice, soft fog effect. I change the opacity to around 25%, and there's a before and after. See, it's a much softer, nicer feel. And we have 3 other Orton effects which do similar things, but this Orton effect Bright will give you an Orton effect, but it's a brighter version of the Orton effect. It's done in a slightly different way. So I'm going to make that invisible and bring down the opacity. And you can see we've brightened up the image. And of course, if you just want to apply it to the shadows or to the highlights, we can just press in the Raya Pro Hub, shadows. And there you go. Orton Effect Warm will create the same Orton effect as Orton Effect Bright, but it will add warmth. Whereas Orton Effect Cold will add a cold temperature to the scene. And that's it for the Dodge and Burn panel. This panel has a huge amount of potential. You just have to explore it a little bit and find out what works for you.